Okay, a little backstory before I tell you one of the crazy experiences of mine that happened during my 2-year security career from 2013 to 2015. I'm a 6'7 male in Australia. I'd like to think I'm a fairly tough and intimidating guy, but some of the shit that used to go on at the mall I used to work the night shift for still gives me goosebumps to this day. So the mall I worked at was a very, very large, probably the largest in my state, I'd say. And all the way up to about 8:30 p.m. it would still be quite busy. Only around 9:30 would we be able to manage to usher all of the stragglers out, and only at about 11 p.m. would all of the business owners have left. My job was basically to patrol the mall and make sure there was no one sticking around after the doors were closed during the night. We didn't have guns or batons, only a can of mace that we very rarely used. There were multiple occasions where we would find would-be thieves hiding around, trying to break into shops after dark, but they were normally far outnumbered by the 4 to 5 of us on shift at the time, and they would usually be intimidated by me or some of the other imposing members of security. This one night though, shit started getting really weird for me on the night shift. So I'd say it was about 2 o'clock, and I was standing in the middle of the empty food court eating a sandwich. This was the only part of the mall that had any light at nighttime due to the skylight, so it was comfortable to eat there. While I was eating though, I heard a dull scraping noise from the hallway leading off from the food courts into some toilets. It sounded like a piece of metal dragging across the floor. I was immediately put on edge, and I flicked on my torch, flashlight, without a moment of hesitation. I can remember creeping down the hallway, flashlight in hand, illuminating a good 6 or 7 meters in front of me. As I got closer and closer to the end of the hall, the noise became louder and louder, until I was at the end of the hallway and there was the toilet doors to the left and right of me. I could tell the sound was coming from the female toilets though. I gripped the handle and opened the door to a tiny little crack. The noise was now very clear and had me not scared, but confused. I yelled, "Oi! Who's in there?" The noise quickly stopped. I paused a moment, listening hard through the tiny cracks of the door, and I swear to fucking God I could hear breathing. Low, male breathing. I shut the door, still gripping the handle tightly, and flicked on my radio.
"This is 1-3. I need help in the food court bathrooms. I think someone's here."
No response. This was really strange and it put me further on edge. Policy was to always answer the radio, and now I was truly becoming quite alarmed.
"This is 1-3, does anyone copy?"
Still no response. I can remember whispering to myself, "What the actual fuck?" I again opened the door a tiny crack.
"Listen, mate,"
I said, sounding as intimidating as possible.
"If you don't fucking come out with your hands up, you're gonna end up eating your teeth tonight. Do you want that?"
I sat there at the door, quite honestly terrified at this point, but there was no response. In fact, now there was no noise at all. I yelled into the bathroom.
"Okay, mate, I'm coming in. If you do anything stupid, it's not my fault. You'll never walk again."
I tried my hardest to sound scary, but my voice was quivering at this point. This whole situation made no sense at all. Why would someone be in the female bathrooms? What was the metal noise? What the fuck is even happening? I very slowly opened the door and scanned my flashlight slowly across the room. All the cubicles were open, which was weird, but other than that, the bathroom was totally empty. I was totally shitting myself about now. I was definitely losing it. I walked into the center of the bathroom, closing the door behind me. Scared to the core, I let out a faint,
"This is some horror movie shit, eh? Come out!"
When I heard the long, whining squeak of the door behind me. I span around, basically crying at this point and shone my torch on a fucking massive man, at least a head taller than me or so it seemed in my state at the time. He was Caucasian, and at least in his 40s with matte gray hair all over his forehead. He was mid-opening the door, but he stopped dead still in the middle of his action. He just looked at me, smiling this guilty fucking smile like a kid would make when he gets caught stealing biscuits or some shit like that. I'm not going to lie, I was so scared I froze. He lifted his finger to his mouth, before swinging the door open all the way and sprinting out with what looked like some type of small metal box in his hand. Turns out he was just behind the toilet when I was opening it, and I totally missed him. I was so fucking close to him, I didn't even fucking notice him. He could have killed me if he had a knife or something, and that thought still haunts me to this day. Later that night, my radio miraculously started working again, and I got right on telling my coworkers about my story. They collectively went pale when I told them what happened. They all had similar stories, but none that were as much of a close shave as mine. I only worked the night shift for another week after that before I quit. I wasn't sticking around a job like that, especially due to the fact that my radio just shit itself. I also never found out whatever happened to that guy. It was winter 2012, and I was 18 or 19 at the time. I was working at a petrol station in an average-sized town in England. It was an okay job, good money for somebody who was at college at the time, and it was just a shame it was a weekend job. So while my friends were getting drunk and having fun, I was in a petrol station serving taxi drivers and the occasional drunk. It started off like any other night. Serve people, clean up, do stock. The average night shift work. Since it was winter, the night was really dark and you could only see faint outlines of people walking back and forth even with streetlights. The place where I worked was situated across the road from a pub and had an alley running beside it that led to a housing estate. Around 3 to 4 a.m. as I finished cleaning a set of shelves, I noticed a figure standing in the alley just out of the light but just enough to hide his face. But you could make out his clothing. I initially brushed it off as somebody waiting for a taxi as it seemed harmless enough. I sat down in my chair behind the counter and looked at my phone and played some games for a bit. When I looked up, it was 5 a.m. and he was still there, waiting, watching me. To make my situation worse, after 5 there was hardly any traffic or passerbys. I had that guttural feeling that he had some harmful intent. I was safe, however, as I locked in till the morning. I stared back in a trance, trying to keep an eye on whatever he would do next. After a while, I needed to use the toilet, so I went and came back thinking that he might have walked off. But he didn't. He was still there. I then decided not to do my last job until my coworker came in to start their shift, as my last job was to take out the fire extinguishers and sand buckets. It got to be about 6 a.m., the figure faded back into the alley, and I didn't see him for the rest of the shift. When my coworker arrived, it was still dark, and I usually walked the 10 minutes back home, but I got a taxi home after that shift. I felt that the guy could be anywhere, still watching me. I told my coworkers and family members about my experience, and they said they personally haven't experienced anything like it and wouldn't like to either. I was very nervous when doing my shifts from then on, feeling like as soon as I let my guard down, he would strike, but thankfully nothing else happened after that. I quit the following summer to go to university. I just finished my first year of university and had taken up a position as a taxi dispatcher with my boyfriend's cousin's taxi company. For the first week and a half, I worked mainly day shifts until the owner decided to extend the hours to 24/7, and I was the lucky employee who would be covering 3 of the 4 of these shifts a week. The next week, I was working my first night shift alone. The driver would be out all night looking for fares, which meant a lot of the night would be just me. I wasn't uneasy working such a shift by myself since I had worked at a 24-hour coffee shop and was used to midnight shifts. It was also a Wednesday or Thursday night, so it wasn't very busy. The best part about this job was that my boss let me use the internet to play video games on my laptop in the office. From the computer desk in the office, I could see the front door, a portion of the front desk, and most of the front windows, so I could keep a close eye on what was happening outside. Plus, the bell above the door always alerted me to a new customer, so I couldn't be caught off guard if I got too into my game. On this particular night, I was working with a taxi driver named Dave. Dave is about 6'3" and 300 pounds, plus he suffers from severe health problems, one of which made all of his movements slow and painful. He definitely wasn't Mr. Fitness or the type of person who would be able to defend himself or others very easily. Sometime during the early hours of the morning, around 1:30 to 2 a.m., Dave gets a call to go pick up someone in a town about 15 minutes away. He gathered up his stuff and drove into the night, while I headed into the office and continued playing my video game. About 15 minutes later, I caught something over the top of my laptop. My mind froze. I could hear panting, and in the reflection of the window, I could see someone sitting in one of the waiting chairs. I walked to the doorway that connects the front room with the office. I glanced into the sitting area and nearly shit bricks. Some guy with a massive rat tail had managed to ninja his way into the office and was now sitting in one of the chairs with his face buried in his hands, panting heavily. He was dirty, sweaty, and sounded like he had just run a marathon. Now, the rat tail should have tipped me off, but I found it more hilarious than frightening. A few moments passed and I finally built up the courage to ask him if he needed a cab. He didn't respond at first. I asked him again, and he looks up at me. I took a step back into the office. His face was scratched and covered in blood from the wound on the top of his head. I was shocked and immediately offered assistance to him. He replies with, "I'm fine. I don't need no help. I just want to go home." I asked him if he needed a cab and, if so, where he was going. He told me he lives about 20 minutes away and wants Dave to take him home. After that, shit started to get weird. I called over to Dave using the radio to tell him that there was a fare in the office and that he wanted a ride. He told me he'd be another 10 minutes or so. My hand was on the phone the entire time in case this guy made any sudden movements. Instead of going back into the office, I decided it was best to stay out front where there are two great big bay windows that make it easy to see what is happening inside the taxi office. I didn't feel as though he was a threat at all, but he seemed really angry at something, so I wanted to make sure that if something happened to me, people would be able to see it. So I walked out into the front room, and as I get closer to the gentleman, that's when I see it. He's not just bleeding from the head, but from the shoulder and knee. I asked him again if he's okay, then I offered to call an ambulance for him. Bad idea.
"You don't need to be doing that," he told me. "It ain't like I killed nobody, right? I never killed nobody. Don't go doing that. You don't need to call anyone. I just want to go home."
"I'm sorry. I just noticed that you're bleeding pretty badly and thought maybe you'd like someone to make sure you're okay," I replied.
"I didn't kill nobody. That asshole should have kept his mouth shut. He had what was coming to him. He shouldn't have said those things. But it ain't like I killed nobody. You don't need to call nobody. I just want to go home."
"Okay," I tell him.
"But you're bleeding."
"It ain't like I killed nobody," he replied.
"I swear I didn't kill nobody. Please don't call the cops. I don't need the cops. I just need to go home. I didn't kill anyone."
Silence for a few minutes. He notices the phone clutched in my hand.
"I fell down," he blurted out.
"Pardon?"
"I fell," he repeated. "That's why I'm bleeding. I fell. It ain't like I killed nobody."
He suddenly got up and started pacing. He was growing impatient for his cab, and I was scared shitless. Blood was now on the chair and floor. I had the phone in my hand, and every once in a while he broke the silence with another string of incoherent babbling about how he had done nothing wrong because he hadn't killed anyone and that I didn't need to call the cops because he was a good guy. Eventually, Dave radios over that he's about 2 minutes away, and I breathe a sigh of relief. He pulled up out front. The man gets into the car, and they drive off. Now I'm worried for Dave, so I call the cops. I reported what happened, and they followed the taxicab to this guy's house, where they arrested him. Turns out this guy had run away from a nearby bar after he had physically assaulted a fellow patron. To what extent, I never found out. He injured him with a sharp object, I assume a pocket knife or needle, took off running, fell and managed to find his way to the taxi office. During his time in the cab office, the police had been searching for him, so technically no, he didn't kill anyone, but he did assault and attempt to murder someone. I also found out that one of the other drivers, Steven, knew the guy from high school years ago. His name is Duke, which explains the rat tail, and he has a history of violence. He also has a history of coming home drunk and cracking his wife's skull open from time to time. Whether he had planned to that night, I couldn't say, but I'm just glad that the guy ended up in the drunk tank for the night. His wife was unharmed, and the guy who got stabbed apparently didn't die. At least, I assume he didn't, since I still see Duke every now and then walking the streets with his glorious rat tail, which means he didn't get arrested. But in all seriousness, I wish you guys could have seen this rat tail. That thing was impressive. Back in 2007, I started a tech job with an IP DT1 long-distance company. The company is no longer around, and honestly, I don't know how they stayed in business as long as they did. It was really a pyramid scam, but thankfully I was on the IT side of things, so I didn't have to sell anything. It was a small, typical tech support call center. The customers would call in, or Verizon, Quest, etc. would call in and say DT1 lines were down or outages. I was the only female on my team, having to prove myself and show that I can do anything my male counterparts could. It didn't take long and the customers respected me for being able to handle things. After making my mark, I decided to take the 10-hour night shifts. I worked Wednesday through Saturday from 1 p.m. to 12 a.m, an hour lunch, and after 6 p.m, I was completely alone in the whole building. The rush to get out of the office by 6 p.m. was insane. I couldn't blame them, but I decided having 3 days off was better than two. Like I said, I was by myself for most of the night. I would have to keep an eye on emails and make sure I answered calls. It was a very slow shift. I would get a lot of video game, reading, schoolwork, and writing done during this time. But sometimes, I would just wander the building, walk around just to get away from my desk for a time. I would have the VoIP phone system connected to my cell phone so no calls would be missed. This allowed me to go get a soda, go get food, and so on. One time while I was up away from my desk, I was going down to the lunchroom to grab a soda. The vending machine was on the basement floor. The basement had a wall of windows and one set of security doors. Same for the main entrance, only there was one camera facing that door. But nothing else to really make you feel very safe. I didn't like going to the basement much because the back of the building faced an acre of dark woods. There was a walking path to the woods, but for some reason they didn't install lights for the walking path. Never really sure why that was, but it didn't help the creepy factor. Sometimes I would see animals run past, but other times I felt like someone was watching me. I always tried my best to make it fast when getting a soda or snack, but sometimes it didn't feel fast enough. So, one night I was making my way down to the basement of the building to get a soda. It was a slow, dragging night, and I needed a little caffeine for a pick-me-up. I counted my money as I walked to make sure I had enough to get in and out quick. But out of the corner of my eye, I saw something dart from the glass door back into the darkness. I stopped dead in my tracks and tried to scan the forest, but like I said, it was just blackness. I felt a bit of unease, and everything told me to turn my heels and go back to my desk. But it was 9 p.m, and I had a fair bit of time left on my shift before I could blow this popsicle stand. I tried shaking the feelings off and briskly walked over to the soda machine and made my selection. The soda dropped, and as I bent down to get it, I heard a loud ping noise. It was as if someone had hit the glass with something. I stood straight up and felt the hair on the back of my neck stand up. I slowly turned around and was scared to see someone out there. But as I made the full turn, I saw once again nothing but darkness. I thought this was a good time to book it back up to the main floor. I didn't bother with the elevator. I went to the stairs and ran up them. My heart was already racing from having to go down there in the first place, then the loud bang, and now running up two flights of stairs. Once I was back at my desk, I sunk down in my chair and tried to calm down. It was just one noise. I was in a building with locked doors and locked inner offices. I kept saying over and over again in my head that it was nothing. I was relieved by that, but out of nowhere I got that feeling of someone watching me again. I peeked up over my cubicle wall and looked around my office. Nothing seemed out of place until I turned to face the front of the building. Outside the first set of doors was a slender, tall, dirty man. He was cupping his hands around his eyes to try and see past the reflecting of the lights inside. I dropped back down into my cubicle before he could catch sight of me. He didn't look like anyone I have ever seen at the office, and it was a little past 9 p.m. There was no good reason why he's checking out my office. As I sit in my chair, I hear the door shake. I slowly stood up and watched him pull at the handles of the doors. They didn't budge, to my relief. But as I watched him, he turned to face me. His face looked bruised or dirty, I couldn't tell which. Once his eyes locked onto mine, he started to bang harder and smack the glass. I was so scared, it was the middle of the night. I was by myself and out in the middle of this office building complex. I grabbed my headset and dialed 911. While getting the operator on the line, the guy was walking back and forth from one side of the glass doors to the next.
911, what's your emergency?
The lady's voice was direct.
Yes, my name is Samantha and I work at Spectrum IT Services Building. I need someone to come out. There's a guy trying to break into my office building.
While speaking with her, the guy disappeared from view. I tried to look in all directions, but I didn't see him. I knew that he wouldn't just walk off, not with how hard he was banging. Out of nowhere, a good-sized rock came out of nowhere and smashed against the door. I screamed and went under my desk. The operator asked what just happened, and I explained that a rock smashed against the glass door. She asked me if the glass was broken enough to let him in. I didn't want to stand up and look, but she told me to look in order to know where he was now. I crawled out from under my desk and just peeked over my wall and saw a huge crack down the first part of the door. I sank back down and told her to please have the police hurry. She said they were on their way. I have read many stories like this before, and people say that the cops couldn't get there fast enough, and they aren't kidding. It feels like time is standing still and you can do nothing. Another smash against the door. But along with that, the sound of glass breaking. Sirens could be heard coming towards my building. It was music to my ears. I told the operator that the police had arrived and thanked her for all her support. I stood back up and looked over the cubicle wall, and the red-blue lights were flashing wildly. But the thing I didn't see was the man. The top part of the door was completely smashed, and the rock was laying on the inside of the entryway. One officer came to the front door and others were out combing the area. I could see their flashlights moving all around the parking lot. The first officer to come in the building and greet me was a very kind man. He was patient with me and let me explain what I saw happen. Soon, my boss arrived and checked on me and then the damage. At some point, my husband was called and I told him I would be escorted home by one of the officers. I took the next few days off and started to look for another job that wasn't by myself at night. When I gave my statement, I explained to the officer that the person could be partnered with an ex-coworker who was fired a few weeks prior for stealing and just not showing up. He knew when people came and went. He knew where we kept the cell phones we were selling, not under lock and key, but under a desk of the provisioner. From smartphones to Blackberries, when they were still worth buying, plus VoIP boxes and phone cards. I went on to leave this job a month later and started at a credit card machine company. It was an office full of people, still a call center, but I felt safer, especially with the security and cameras all over the building. Like I said before, this company is no longer around. It was bought up by another company, and they basically liquidated all of the funds that were worth something. So, dirty man who tried to break into my office, let's never meet again. This happened back in 2010. I was working in a hotel in a suburban area, nice place. When I first started there, I was both a PT front desk clerk and a PT night auditor. For those of you not in hospitality, I closed the day out on the computers on the overnight shift. I had just been promoted to a day job and had a week left at the front desk before I was switching to my Monday through Friday gig, and it was just like any other night. At about 3 a.m., I received a phone call. The guy sounded my age, mid-20s, and attempted to strike up a conversation with me. I have to give my name when answering the phone, so he gets my name, of course, and starts asking me personal questions. Do you have a boyfriend? Would you want to go out for a drink, etc.? Which were harmless, but nevertheless I tell him I'm hanging up as I had a job to do. He wouldn't give me a name. Instead he said, "Why don't you call me John?" I hang up and finish my shift. The next night at about 3:30 a.m., I receive another phone call from John. He started off with asking me out for a drink again, to which I declined and hung up the phone. He called back about 5 times that night, each time getting more lewd in his comments and just tried to keep me talking. He ended his last call with the phrase, "I see you like singing karaoke. I love doing that. Let's go out together sometime." Shit, I think. He found me on Twitter. I had just gone out for a few nights prior with my friends and posted about it. I asked him how he got my full name and he wouldn't tell me. I hung up again and he was done for that night. I deleted my Twitter and Foursquare pages, and when my boss came in at 7 a.m., I told him what had been going on. We told my GM and my security guard put it into his record. I only worked 2 overnights a week, luckily, but when I came back the next week, so did he. The phone calls started at around 3 a.m. and lasted for an hour or so, but this time was a little different. John was angry that I had deleted my accounts so he couldn't keep an eye on me and make sure I wasn't cheating on him. I told him to fuck off, and that I'm not answering the phone anymore. My security guard will be taking all of my calls going forward. The phone was quiet for about 10 seconds, and then he screamed,
"You're going to be with me whether or not you like it. I'm coming for you,"
and hung up the phone. I, of course, freaked the fuck out and called the police. Luckily, I had my security guard there, so I wasn't completely alone. But it must have been a slow night because it took the cops mere minutes to get there. I called my night shift supervisor, who left at 11 p.m., and he managed to calm me down. One cop was nice enough to stay until my shift was done. And with that, I told my boss that even though I had a week left of overnights, I couldn't and wouldn't do it. Thankfully, they understood, and I moved to daytime hours, as well as sent an email out to everyone telling them that anyone who called for me was sent directly to the GM. Thankfully, everything stopped after that, minus a few phone calls the security guy got for about a week. He told the guy that I had quit because of him, and the calls stopped. This happened in the fall of 1993. When I was 20 years old. In the interest of context, this was before I started college, and I was working in the material prep department of a plastics factory on the night shift. I was the only woman in the department, and my male coworkers were initially skeptical that I could handle the job. but I proved myself and earned their respect. It was hard work, but on the plus side, it also put me in the best shape of my life. It was also about this time that I dumped my abusive boyfriend. He was verbally, emotionally, and physically abusive, as well as an alcoholic. This fact, more than anything, is probably why I got myself into this situation in the first place. I had just gotten off of work, and it was about 1:30 a.m. My car was running on fumes, so I stopped at a local gas station to fill up. While I was pumping gas, a woman about my age approached me looking nervous and scared. She said that she had been at her boyfriend's house and they had a fight. She walked up to the gas station to use the payphone and call a friend to pick her up. On her way to the station, a car pulled up as she was walking and the guys inside started catcalling and harassing her. With a slight movement of her head, she indicated a car that was parked off to the side by the gas station dumpsters. I saw a large light green car, like a Caddy or a Lincoln, with at least two or three shadowy figures inside. She said they threatened her, and she was too scared to call her friend and wait. The woman was neat, well-dressed, and didn't seem high or drunk or anything like that. She just seemed really nervous and freaked out, so I didn't even hesitate. I finished pumping my gas and told her to hop in the car, that I'd take her home. At that time on a weeknight, there was little traffic, so I booked it right out of the gas station and asked her where she lived. She kept twisting around in the seat to see if the car was behind us, and when I asked her to put her seatbelt on, she ignored me and kept looking for the car. I assumed she was just scared. A few blocks down the road, however, I noticed she was looking around the car, and she started asking me about money.
"Where's your purse? Where's your bag? I need money. You need to give me some money."
My stomach sank. I have this woman in my car, and now she's gonna rob me? Fuck. But when I thought about it, robbery just didn't make much sense. I was driving a 1985 Chevette, affectionately nicknamed Shitbox, and was wearing my work clothes, a ratty t-shirt and jeans with combat boots. I did not look like a person with a lot of cash, primarily because I wasn't a person with a lot of cash. She twisted around the seat again and started yelling,
"There they are! There they are!"
She didn't sound scared anymore. I checked the rear view, and sure enough, the light green car is right behind me. She started cackling and bouncing up and down in the seat.
"My boys are gonna fuck you up, bitch. They're gonna fuck you up."
She's laughing like crazy, opening the glove box, looking in the back for a bag or purse, telling me all the messed up shit these guys are planning to do to me. Now, if I had been smart, I would have just driven to the police station. Actually, if I had been very smart, I would have called the cops from the gas station and waited with her until they arrived. That would have been the intelligent thing to do. Unfortunately, none of this crossed my mind until later. In the moment, I just got really, really fucking angry. I realized three key things all at once. There was an intersection up ahead, with cars on either side waiting to cross, and the light had just turned yellow. I had a spare box cutter that I kept for work in the driver's side door compartment. The crazy bitch still hadn't put on her seatbelt. I didn't think. I floored it and passed under the yellow light just as it turned red. I glanced back to see if the green car was still behind me, but the cross traffic at the intersection had just started to move and they hadn't caught up. The bitch started yelling. I slammed on the brakes and she hit the dash and windshield with a solid and viciously satisfying crack. When she rebounded to the passenger seat, I had the box cutter in her face and was screaming some serious batshit crazy stuff. I can't remember exactly what I said, but it was along the lines of, "Get the fuck out! Get the fuck out of my car before I cut off your face and make you eat it, bitch!" The crazy screaming and box cutter combo worked. She grabbed blindly at the handle and popped the door open. I started shoving and punching her until the bitch tumbled out the door to the curb. I stomped on the gas, got to the next turn, and squealed around it with the passenger's door still open. I made a few more turns because I was afraid that the green car might catch up to me. After a little while, I stopped to close the passenger door, and then I cut across town and got onto the highway to go home. I was on the highway for about 5 minutes before the shake started. I pulled off to the shoulder to calm down and get my shit together, and then I drove home. I told my sister I was living with her temporarily after the breakup with my ex about everything that had just happened. She wrapped me in a tight bear hug while simultaneously yelling about how stupid I was for not going to the police. I've never been so glad to be yelled at in my life.
So this happened to me 2 years ago. It was my first month on the job, and I worked night security at this pretty interesting place. For the record, I still work there, and I have more strange stories possibly to tell in the future. I'm a 38-year-old male, and I've worked security jobs most of my life, and the graveyard shift. I was an event security guard for various well-known concert venues for years, so I've seen my fair share of strange things and crazy people. In other words, I don't scare easily, and hardly ever go into panic mode when a crisis comes up. The place I currently work at is a resort-style apartment complex. To get a better idea of the layout, there are 3 floors with 50 apartments on each floor. This place takes up 1 city block with a golf course in back, indoor swimming pools, hot tubs, and a small movie theater. You name it, this place has it. Most of the residents are retired doctors, lawyers, and otherwise rich. There are some younger people that live here as well, stockbrokers and real estate agents and so on. Some just use their apartment in the summer and leave as soon as the snow falls. It's located in a well-known tourist town in the United States. The building itself has 12 exits on the first floor. The doors are locked at 11 p.m. You can exit, but you can't get back in unless you go to the front of the building and ask to be buzzed in, or pick up the call box phone next to whatever exit you're at. The front lobby is set up much like a hotel, with sliding glass doors which I lock when I start my shift. In the middle of the building on the first floor, there are 2 big slider doors which I also lock. They lead to a private parking lot. The parking lot itself is gated, and you need a code to get in. This was midsummer. And while it's never really hot here, tonight was the exception. It was still very warm after the sun had set. I came in 10 minutes to 11 to start my shift. We have a routine to hand off the keys, event log, and phone to the next person on duty. Despite its size, I am the only security person here at night. My coworker who was leaving told me that the side iron gates that lead to the parking lot are open on one side because they are stuck. This is nothing new, and they often do get jammed. She told me that the repair people would be in sometime tomorrow to fix them, but just to do some extra patrols out there at night. This place sits across the road from a public park, and while the area is pretty decent, the park tends to breed druggies and homeless people at night, who sometimes like to try and wander on the property or cause trouble. My night started out as uneventful. As a security guard in this place, we only have pepper spray, a large flashlight, keys, and a company cell phone to call 911 if need be. We are not to confront with bodily harm, nor can we detain anyone. We are simply eyes and ears, and to call the police if something comes up. Of course, you can defend yourself if you need to, but in all cases, if you're in danger, calling the police is company policy. Basically, I am to walk the grounds and floors for anyone suspicious, watch the cameras in the security office which is in the lobby, and otherwise try to stay alert. If a resident calls for a maintenance request, I would take down the information in the computer for the day shift, or if a resident called with a security issue, I would attend to it. Pretty easy enough job, I thought. I locked the doors to the parking lot and the lobby doors. I did a sweep of all the floors and then found myself back at the desk. It was really quiet, and it rolled around to 3 a.m., and I just sat down to eat my lunch when the company cell phone rang. The caller ID let me know that it was from outside one of our call boxes. I picked it up and said,
"Thanks for calling. This is Security Officer James. How can I help you?"
I glanced at the cameras and could see the shadow of a figure standing just out of reach from the door and the view of the camera. All I could see is the open call box and the metal cord from the phone. I again asked how could I help. The man started to breathe even heavier, and then he laughed. Then silence. It was one of those laughs you hear in a movie when the lunatic is about to do something terrible. I got up from my chair and started to walk out of the office and to the door he was at when it rang again. This time from call box number 2, which was further down. I quickly looked at the camera and saw this large figure in a hooded jacket. I knew this was strange as it was very warm outside. He was holding a black bag in his hands, but he had his back to the camera.
"I'm coming for you, and you're gonna die,"
this voice said in a raspy, deep tone. He hung up before I had the chance to say anything. Then the phone rang again. This time I picked up, and before he could speak, I let him know the cops were on their way and to leave the property now, as he is on camera. He tried the doors, and both were locked. This time he was at yet another call box. This guy had to be running at top speed to make it to the next call box, as they were a good distance between the doors on the outside.
"I can see you. Are you ready to die? The cops won't make it here in time,"
the guy said. I spoke loud and pretended like I was talking to another security guard and asked him to send 3 other security guards to such and such location and that the police were dispatched. The guy slammed the phone down loud against the call box receiver, and I watched him on camera take off into the darkness towards the park area. I figured I had scared him off. I was going to call the police, but honestly, with the location of this place, it would have took them at least 15 minutes to get here. And I figured this guy was just some tweaker from the park. I scanned the cameras and patrolled the back lot just to be sure no one was there. I had my pepper spray in my hands just in case, but no one was out there. I returned to my desk and I wrote what happened in the incident log. About a half hour had passed, I had finished my lunch and was just about to do my rounds when I heard the phone ringing again. This time it was from an unknown number. I thought it would be a resident calling for a repair issue or something. I picked it up and said my normal line.
"Where are the cops? I don't see them, but I see you,"
the voice said. Fuck, it was that guy again. I scanned the cameras and did not see anything. I went to the front door to look out, and there was nothing but darkness and a few floodlights on.
"I know you're alone, and you're going to die soon," he said.
I basically told him to get fucked and hung up. I called the non-emergency number to the police and let them know what was going on. The dispatcher said she would send a car out to check the area and make contact with me. The next thing I hear is a loud thud against the glass window to the day manager's office, which sits across from the security room. Another 3 loud bangs. I run to the door and unlock it. I pull up the shades and shine my flashlight through the window into the darkness. I catch the face of this hooded man. He looked to be about 40, with long stringy hair and these wild eyes. He looked right at me and grinned before slamming his head into the window again, trying to break it. I started yelling at him and told him that the cops were coming and he needs to get the fuck out of here. That's when he pulled the biggest damn butcher knife I've ever seen and made a slicing motion like he would use it to cut my throat. This guy was crazy and probably on drugs. He continued slamming his body against the glass, trying to break it. He used his head to try to break the window, but managed to bust his head open. So the window now has blood all over it. I backed out of the office and locked the door. I then decided to wait for the cops as this guy was out of control and my pepper spray wasn't going to stop him. And the last thing I wanted was to handle a bloody crazy person. He then ran to the nearest side door and took the call box phone off the hook. He then ran to each call box and removed all the phones, which caused my company cell phone to ring and jam up the line. This guy had to be on meth or something because he ran as fast as I could imagine. I watched the camera and noticed to my horror, the sliding glass door on the garage was open. Now it was common for residents to get out of their cars and unlock the door themselves. It's just a sliding lock, like the kind in department stores. But this was the last thing I needed with this nut job running around. I sprinted across the building and took a shortcut through a couple of banquet rooms to make it to the garage. As I was doing so, I saw that crazy guy running up the garage pathway. I slid that door as fast as I could and locked it before he got into the entryway. He then slammed his body into the glass over and over, but the door did not move. I locked the second set of doors just in case he got through the outside ones. He would at least be trapped or slowed down. I reached for my pepper spray, thinking maybe he would just leave, and I yelled, "The cops are here." He started to laugh and howl, and then held the knife up again before running into the darkness of the parking garages. I called the cops on my personal cell phone to let them know that the man has a knife. The dispatcher told me that the cops would be there shortly, and I let her know what happened. I made my way to the front again and locked myself in the security office. At least this place had no windows, and I could watch on camera. I heard another loud thud and realized he was at the front lobby doors trying to get in. I was hoping the cops would roll up at any minute, but they didn't. And while it probably didn't take them long, it felt like forever at this point. The guy was standing at the lobby doors with the knife in hand. He faced the camera, and by this time his hood had fallen back. The top of his head was bald, with wild, long, stringy, crazy hair on the sides of his head. His eyes were huge, and I will never forget that grin on his face as he mouthed to the camera,
"Die. Die."
While making stabbing motions with that knife, blood running across his face from slamming into the glass. He then ran out into the darkness. About 5 minutes later, the cops showed up. They sent one officer. He asked what the guy looked like, and I told him that I have camera footage. He drove through the area first and shined his spotlight. The cop returned to tell me that he couldn't find anyone, and he had driven around the entire block and back area behind the golf course. I showed him the footage and printed out the picture from the camera. The cop said he didn't see any sign of the guy, and that he would patrol the area and call back if he came again. It was now nearly 5 a.m. when the cop left. I waited until about 6 a.m., when it was daylight and people were starting to get out and about, before I walked around and hung up all the phones. This guy literally took all 12 phones off the hook. When my manager came in the morning shift at 8 a.m., I told her what happened, and she said that they would keep an eye out, and they would have a meeting to let everyone who worked here know and to be aware. They had an extra security guard on my shift for 2 weeks, but thankfully the guy never returned.